Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. On today's program, John Russell tells of a train trip to less popular places in Italy. Jill Robbins and I report on how disasters affect U.S. counties. Brian Lynn reports on U.S. congressional efforts to protect kids, followed by the lesson of the day. So, let's get started.
As it moves across central Italy, an old train pulling carriages from the 1930s and 1950s crosses the forests of the Maiella National Park and the Abruzzo Highlands. Across 100 kilometers, the Park Railway, also known as the Italian Trans-Siberian, travels through valleys and tunnels and over old bridges called viaducts. It offers visitors a view of small, rural, and hidden villages in the country. It was the first of some 1,000 kilometers of rail line to have reopened under a project by Fondazione FS, part of the state-controlled National Rail Company. The project, called Timeless Tracks, aims to take visitors to forgotten parts of Italy instead of the popular cities. These are tracks that have lived through different eras. They have carried soldiers to the front, cows to pasture. They were mistakenly considered unproductive during the 1960s and 70s, but are now once again of value, Luigi Cantamessa, who heads Fondazione FS, told Reuters. Inspired by train travel in Switzerland, the project now carries 45,000 visitors a year across its 13 lines. Fondazione FS expects to open two new ones by 2026, both in the southern area of Sicily. What were considered to be the dry branches of Italy's train network have now proved to be the green shoots, Cantamessa added. Norma Paggiati is a 28-year-old from Florence, Italy, traveling on the train with two friends. Paggiati said, "People are used to cities and places, like Florence, that everyone knows. But then there are other areas that need to be discovered. This is the right kind of tourism that does not spoil the authenticity of places." Laura Colaprete, a local guide, said the trains draw Italians and foreigners, families and children. The Trans-Siberian's first stop is in Palena, a hilltop town known for its beautiful views over the national park. The train helps several small towns around here. "This line was a dead line before," said Gino Topi, 60, as he helped his wife with the food stand in the small station. Milan's Bocconi University recently estimated that for every dollar spent by passengers on tickets, as much as three more are spent on food, tours, and other purchases. I'm John Russell.
When it comes to disasters in the United States, most people think of major storms and earthquakes that hit coastal areas. But a study from the nonprofit Rebuild by Design and New York University says disasters happen everywhere across the country. The study looks at information on hundreds of federally declared disasters from 2011 to about 2021. It also examines the $60 billion that the Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA, gave state and local governments. The study finds that 8 of the 9 counties with the most federally declared disasters since 2011 are in Kentucky. One is in Vermont. These counties have several times the number of disasters as the national average of 3 in the past 13 years.
A federal disaster is declared when a bad natural event is so costly that local government officials do not believe they can recover. So the governor of the state asks the president to declare a disaster, which frees federal money set aside for this purpose. Amy Chester is director of Rebuild by Design. She said, "California and Louisiana, and I would say now even Texas, Florida for sure, they soak up all the oxygen when you hear about these giant storms." Chester added, "But what you're not hearing about are these storms that are happening all the time. And that's just becoming regular to places like Vermont." Chester also noted Tennessee, Oklahoma, Mississippi, Iowa, and Alaska as having a lot of disasters. "We want to show that climate change is already here," Chester said of the data, which covers 2011 to 2023. "It does not include heat waves, lack of rain, or diseases like COVID-19. Before she studied the data, Chester said she thought Vermont would be safe from climate change. Instead, it has many disasters. "It's awful," Chester said. "It just keeps happening to them. Vermont recently flooded again because of heavy rain from Hurricane Beryl."
In July 2022, at least 40 people died and 300 homes were damaged when a flood struck Floyd County in eastern Kentucky. It was the 13th time in 12 years that the federal government declared the rural county a disaster. Judge Robbie Williams is the administrator of the county with about 35,000 people. He said, "After that flood, I had 500 homeless people looking at me. Judge, what are we going to do?" Williams added, "It's overwhelming, and it's just a matter of time before it happens again." Then, in 2023, Floyd County was declared a disaster again for the 14th time since 2011. But Floyd County is not the nation's most disaster-prone county. Neighboring Johnson County has had 15 disasters declared by FEMA. Floyd County's government received more than $35 million in FEMA disaster aid since 2011. But that is not a lot of money compared to other counties hit by hurricanes. 5 counties received more than $1 billion in FEMA aid. 3 of them are in New York State. They are led by Manhattan's New York County, which got $8.9 billion after being struck by Hurricane Sandy in 2012. FEMA notes that flooding is the most common disaster in the U.S. Since 2011, FEMA has paid more than $41 billion in aid following hurricanes, the most of any kind of disaster. Susan Cutter is with the Hazards Vulnerability and Resilience Institute at the University of South Carolina. Cutter said, "What the data tell us is that the frequency and severity of disasters at local state scales is increasing, with rural, suburban, and urban places being affected nationwide." She was not involved in Chester's research, but she added, "More needs to be done."
In Floyd County, Judge Williams said, "Geography and government regulations make it tough for the area. The county is in the mountains. People live in the narrow valleys," he said. "When it rains, the creeks and rivers overflow. We're seeing historic levels of flooding," Williams said. "It's only getting worse." Environmental regulations bar local officials from dredging the creeks. Silt from the mountains keeps building up, Williams said. Some creeks were about 6 meters deep, but are now shallow enough to walk across, he said. "The problem is, there is nowhere for the rain to go," Williams said. Samantha Montano is a professor of emergency management at the Massachusetts Maritime Academy. Montano said, "What is more important is how state and local policies create or reduce the risk of future disasters." In Floyd County, the local government is using FEMA money to buy the homes of 150 residents to move them out of a flood area. But some do not want to leave, Williams said. "Until we get those homes out of these floodways, we're still going to have these issues," Williams added. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
The U.S. Senate has approved the nation's first major legislation aimed at protecting children from internet harms. Two bills passed the Senate by a vote of 91-3 on Tuesday. But the measures will also need to be passed by the U.S. House of Representatives to become law. It is currently unclear whether the House will approve the bills in the future. One bill is known as the Kids Online Safety Act, or COSA. The other is called the Children's Online Privacy Protection Act, or COPPA 2.0. The COSA bill requires technology companies to take steps to provide a duty of care to protect young users. This legal term covers a range of steps businesses need to take in an effort to prevent and mitigate harm to children. Such harms include bullying and violence, as well as online information related to suicide, eating disorders, and substance and sexual abuse. The bill, known as COPPA 2.0, is designed to increase privacy rules related to children. The bill bans some targeted advertising to kids online. It also bars data collection on children without their knowledge or approval. And it gives parents and young users the ability to remove personal information from social media services. In addition, the bills would require companies to permit minors to opt out of product tools that use activity history to predict and suggest additional content to keep users online for long periods. The bill empowers state attorney general representatives to enforce most parts of the laws. However, the duty of care part cannot be enforced by state attorneys general. That change was made after concerns were raised that some states may seek to block information related to LGBTQ issues or reproductive rights. Wider enforcement will be dealt with by the Federal Trade Commission, FTC, which will help decide what kinds of content is harmful to children. COSA and COPPA 2.0 are being supported by a wide range of nonprofits, technology accountability organizations, and parental rights groups. In addition, the bills have been supported by major groups representing American doctors and teachers. Some well-known technology companies, including Microsoft, X, and Snap, have also expressed support. Meta, which owns Facebook, Instagram, and WhatsApp, has not publicly expressed strong support or opposition to the measures. Meta has said in the past it is not completely against some government regulation of social media. Some technology industry groups and the American Civil Liberties Union, ACLU, have criticized the measures. They have suggested that differing definitions of what is considered harmful to children could result in minors being blocked from important information. Such information could include LGBTQ issues, reproductive rights, or vaccines. Some changes were made earlier to the legislation in an effort to overcome these concerns, but some critics said those did not go far enough. They made improvements, but not enough, said Democratic Senator Ron Wyden of Oregon. He was one of three senators who voted against the bills. He recently told reporters, "I still think it is going to harm a lot of LGBTQ kids because of the way it's going to make it difficult for them to get information." Josh Gollan is executive director of Fair Play, a nonprofit group working to protect children from online marketing and other possible harms. He told the Associated Press before the Senate vote that he is very hopeful the bills will eventually be passed by both houses of Congress. "The reason it has not come to a vote yet is that passing legislation is really hard, particularly when you're trying to regulate one of the, if not the most powerful industry in the world," Gollan said. I'm Brian Lynn.
And now Brian Lynn joins me to talk more about his technology report. Thanks for being here, Brian.
Sure, Mario. Thank you for having me.
This week you reported on new legislation passed in the U.S. Senate that aims to protect children from online harms. As was mentioned in the report, these two measures would still need to pass the House of Representatives to become law. What are the chances that it will be passed by both houses of Congress?
So this is a very interesting question for sure, but one that is also difficult to answer at this point. One positive sign for supporters of these bills is that they passed the Senate with near unanimous support. Only three lawmakers voted against them. So if that same support exists in the House, the bills have a very good chance at being approved as they are currently written.
Okay. And what has been the reaction so far among House members and the leadership to these bills passing in the Senate?
So there have been some House members who have been very supportive of these measures in public, And House Speaker Mike Johnson is the one who would be responsible for putting the legislation to a vote on the House floor. And so far, he has not spoken directly to that issue. But in recent days, Johnson did tell reporters he was committed to working with House members to, in his words, find consensus on the measures, meaning that at least he's open to trying to make them work. And at this point, legislative experts are saying that the passage in the Senate could make it possible that these could be approved in the House before the end of the current session, which ends in January.
Okay. Thanks again for joining me, Brian.
You're welcome, Mario. Thank you.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Jill Robbins, and I'm joined by Andrew Smith. Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Jill.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Ana introducing herself.
Hello. My name is Ana Mateo.
Lesson 27 of Level 2 of this series shows a few ways to make friendly and informal invitations. We'll listen to those examples, and we'll listen to some expressions and show you how to use them.
Okay, in our first example, Ana's boss, Ms. Weaver, invites Ana to a dinner at a restaurant.
Hello, Ms. Weaver.
Oh, Ana, I've invited some people to dinner Saturday. We're going to that new seafood restaurant, Fish on a Dish. Why don't you join us? My treat.
We can say the three words, "Why don't you?" at the beginning of an invitation. It means the same thing as, would you like to? We use why don't you with friends or when we do not want to sound too formal. Jill, why don't you explain the expression, my treat?
All right, I will. Listen to Ms. Weaver again.
Why don't you join us? My treat.
My treat simply means that Ms. Weaver will pay for dinner.
For example, if you are at a restaurant with a few friends or family members and you want to pay for everyone, you can take the bill and say, my treat.
Another way of saying my treat is to say, it's on me. If I say, it's on me, that means I want to pay for it. But if I say dinner's on me, that might mean that I spilled my plate in my lap.
Yes, in the literal physical sense, that's true. After Ms. Weaver asks Ana to dinner, Ana politely says that she cannot join her. To do this, she simply begins with the word thanks.
Thanks, Ms. Weaver, but I already have plans. My friend has invited me to her houseboat.
Houseboat? Really? That's unique.
Yes, it is. In fact, I'm thinking of living on a houseboat.
The word unique means very special or being the only one of its kind.
And notice how Ana talks about the future by using the present progressive tense.
Yes, it is. In fact, I'm thinking of living on a houseboat.
When we say the three words, I'm thinking of, and then add an ing verb, that means we are considering or planning a future action.
Right. So, for example, I'm sitting at my desk right now, but I'm thinking of going for a walk with my friend later today.
Sounds like a good idea. Now, let's hear Ms. Weaver's reaction to Ana.
Yes, it is. In fact, I'm thinking of living on a houseboat.
Aren't you too tall and klutzy to live on a houseboat?
I am not too tall. Sorry.
Ms. Weaver uses the adjective klutzy. That means someone who does not have good control of their body and tends to have little accidents.
Oh, you mean like me? For example, if you are klutzy, you might drop a glass or knock over some object like a desk lamp or bump into something. Klutzy is spelled K-L-U-T-Z-Y.
In the video, Anna knocks over two signs in the hallway at work just after she says she is not too tall.
The noun form of klutzy is the word klutz, and a synonym of klutzy is clumsy. That's spelled C-L-U-M-S-Y. Andrew, I noticed the two words sound similar.
They do sound similar, but, you know, one is spelled with a K and the other with a C, and the other has a Z and one has an S, so there are some differences there. And the words have different origins or language roots. Klutzy comes from Yiddish, and clumsy from an older form of English.
Now, let's hear Anna arriving at her friend's houseboat. Her friend's name is Fanny. Listen for the way Fanny asks her son to show Anna the boat.
Anna, I'm so glad you could come.
Hi, Fanny.
Hi, this is my son, Phoenix.
Hi, Phoenix.
Hello.
How about you give Anna a tour, and I will make some lunch.
Fanny used the informal expression of the two words, how about, to ask her son, Phoenix, to show Anna the boat. During Anna's visit on the boat, she starts to feel seasick. We sometimes get seasick because of the movement of a boat on the water. We say the boat rocks back and forth.
Can you stop this boat from rocking for a minute?
The problem for Anna is that the boat continues to rock. Later, Fanny notices that Anna does not feel well.
Anna, are you feeling okay?
Yeah. I just need some fresh air.
Let me open a window for you.
No, I need some fresh land air. I need to breathe air on land. Is that the time? I should really be going. Thanks for lunch, Fanny, and a tour of your houseboat. It's given me a great idea.
You're gonna live on a houseboat?
Sort of. Thanks again.
At the end of the video, we see the idea Anna was talking about. She invites Ms. Weaver to hang out or spend time on a boat.
Hi, how would you like to hang out on my boat? Great, see you then.
This time, Anna uses the more formal expression, would you like to? However, by adding the word how at the beginning, she makes it sound just a little bit less formal. Listen again.
Hi, how would you like to hang out on my boat? Great, see you then.
At the end of the video, we see Anna and Ms. Weaver sitting in a small boat on the grass in Anna's yard.
And Ms. Weaver does not look too excited about it.
No, she doesn't. But hey, at least she doesn't have to worry about getting seasick. I've been seasick before, and I can tell you, it's not fun.
Yeah, but I've heard acupuncture is helpful, or just pinching on your ears when you feel seasick.
Well, I wish I had known that at the time. Well, before our listeners get sick of listening to me, let's remind them that each lesson of the Let's Learn English series has a lesson plan that they can download for free from our website. The plans can be helpful for both students and teachers.
And remember that you can find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.